New Yorker, because I know maybe a couple of people in the room, and his name is like, any of you possibly come here to New York for this, and so I really appreciate you coming. I just ended up with this gentleman here, Aaron Brayship, 2 years ago from the Fireproof. So it's always nice when people come back, because that means we did something like 2 years ago, and you chose to join us again today. I'm very happy. That you can't see it very well, but it is crucifix, and it looks very poetic and ambery and beautiful. It seems to fade in light, and it has this wonderful amber color to the photograph. And then you see the title of it, and the name of the piece is Immersion, but they put a piece, it was originally called Immersion, but then it came to be known locally as Piss Christ. And it was first shown by Seven Stops in 1987 in his galleries on Spring Street, which is East Soho. And it was originally very well received by the New York Art World, and then it came to become known by people outside of the art world. And then it suddenly became sort of a conversation point by people in the government, and kind of set a shockwave that went around the world. And why that was very important to me was I was, at the time, a very young teenager. I didn't live in New York. I was in, I was in like agricultural America, and we didn't have art programs. We didn't have it. Like, visual art was not part of our curriculum. And so, I had studied a lot of music and I had taken a lot of piano lessons, but just the concept of living in New York and making work with my hands and having this combination between doing something with my hands and doing something with my mind as a vocation just wasn't in the set of things that I could do. And so I just remember like reading like a Time magazine, and this image was on the cover of it. And people were so upset. And it was like this crazy thing, like this thing that looked so beautiful where you just changed one little thing. One little thing. Like if it had just been called Light Christ and you had shown the same image, it would have passed because it looked like that. But then you just said, piss. And suddenly everyone's perception. And here we are, it's like 30 years later, and in this country, if you're an individual artist, you can't get federal funding from our government because we've set all kinds of special laws to make sure that this does not happen again. And it just like, it got me into the game. And it set me on a course that, you know, like how many ever years later, like I'm here and I'm part of this, and this image is why. I'm happy to say that this image also touched me. It's touched me 2 times in my life. So I own a gallery that I founded that is, we're now in our 2nd year. And it is probably fair that if like you hear like Christopher Stout Gallery, that it probably shouldn't mean anything to you. And the true thing, which actually makes me very happy, is that people remember artists. Like if you, like I can tell you who showed this, Stephen Stockson, I can show you that Yvonne Lambert, which was formerly a Paris gallery that was 45 years ago, and that probably doesn't mean anything to us. But like the art and the artist is the thing that you remember, and that's what's important. So we've been around for about 1.5 years, and we've shown some things so far that have gone around the world and have been on television all around the world and have made an impact. And this image image and thinking about that image was the reason that convicted me to start a gallery. 2.5 years ago, when I was like kind of kicking, like, what do I want to do? What do I want to do? Like, I've been making art for a while, I want to grow, but how do I grow? There started to be a lot of conversations in our country about the topic of gentrification. And about, you know, there, gentrification means, if we all defined it, we would all probably have a different definition. But there's such a thing as intellectual gentrification and philosophical gentrification, and people started talking about very loudly about how, as New York became wealthier and wealthier, and as, you know, like, it became harder and harder to live here and to make it because of the cost of living, that things were dying, things were being in danger of dying. And one of the things that people started talking about very strongly is that also because of how much it costs to get an arts education, and because artists were walking around with $100,000 in debt because of their MFAs, that suddenly it was directly informing the kind of work that they were making, because they were suddenly thinking, I have to make this money back, I have to pay my debt, I have to pay my landlord, I have to pay this, I have to pay that. And, you know, people talk about living in New York as being, like, if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere, but we've always fought against different things. So maybe at one point in our lives in New York, we were fighting against AIDS, maybe at one point we were fighting against crack, maybe at one point we were fighting against crime. You know, the big thing that we as New Yorkers and we as artists in New York seem to be fighting about now is this sort of like financial thing that's just so hard to find the money to make it here and then have to be able to still save the best of us for our art. So I was thinking about all those kinds of things, and it was exactly that sort of the need to make a space and to create a place in the market for that kind of work. Because to me personally, it's just so essential, you know. And when I go into museums, which I'm lucky to do, when I go to the museum, when I go to the Whitney, when I go to MoMA, when I go to all these places, you know, the work I see has this same sort of tooth, and it challenges. And so it's important to me to do my part to make sure that it's also